Good morning everyone, and that's a fresh start, a new day in the Braille Hall, and I would like to welcome everybody out here. And at the outset, I would like to thank the AIC Governing Council, the organizers, and the scientific committee for giving us this opportunity to host this instruction course in this prestigious conference out here. This is for the first time we are going to have a virtual conference, but it is giving the same flavor. We all are energized and geared up for this academic extravaganza, and we are all here together for an instruction course to instruct that how to switch for topical anesthesia. We are going to block the block. Our content is to block the block and avoid peri-vulvar or retro-vulvar anesthesia and shift to topical anesthesia. So topical anesthesia is all about what hurdles and challenges we face in this anesthesia and how to go about it, and what are the tips and tricks in each surgery which we can take up to have a good surgery done under topical anesthesia with satisfactory outcomes for the patient and the surgeon's perspective both. So the chief instructor for this course is Professor Sanjeev Gupta sir, our mentor, our teacher, who has really worked hard and is a pioneer in surgery under topical anesthesia, and his initiation and hard work has brought us together on this platform today. And I would like to thank and welcome you sir. And with him is definitely Professor Prakash from Chittagong here to give his keynote address. Welcome you, sir. We have Dr. Rajat, famous thrombectomy surgeon, the consultant at King George's Medical University, Lucknow. And we have Professor Siddharth Agarwal, the pioneer strabismus surgeon, who will be giving insight on topical surgery with strabismus, topical anesthesia with strabismus surgery. And Dr. Navindu Rai, the joint secretary of the UP State Ophthalmic Society, the young entrepreneur from Devaria, he is joining with us today to give his inputs on phacoemulsification and topical anesthesia. To start off with the session, I would take the first presentation giving insights on what this topical anesthesia is all about and what preparations we need as surgeon and on the patient so as to have a good and safe surgery. So I would be sharing my screen now. Is it fine? The screen is visible?
Yes, boss.
Okay, that's great. So I would be taking up the preparations for topical anesthesia and how to switch from local to topical. Now, the choice is yours. Just imagine yourself as patient and see on the OT table these two scenes. What would you like to have it in your own eye? And then this is going to change your post-op outcome, the way you want to be after your own surgery. And remember that don't expect to receive if you are not willing to give. So now, why to go topical? What is the need? First of all, it is very, very safe. There is no risk of bleed in the orbit, no chances of optical nerve injury or perforation of globe. There are no chances of ptosis, no black eyes, no raccooning, and is very safe with patients on antiplatelets and with thrombocytopenia or bad quality of platelets, what we call. So in those cases, we are really safe with topical anesthesia. It is really effective. A good anesthesia can be achieved with proparacaine drops. Surgery can be performed with minimal discomfort, and it gives a very fast rehabilitation and patient satisfaction after surgery. You see the two pictures down here, and there is a hell lot of difference in the mind of patient when he sees his eyes like this. So eyes look as normal as before after topical anesthesia. So here we are to recommend this. It is really good for surgeon also. When we do surgery under topical anesthesia, it improves our tissue handling. The handling becomes really more delicate and surgeries become very fast. I repeat, surgeries become fast if done under topical. There is no wastage of time in super pinky, putting blocks and waiting for blocks to come, repeating blocks. So all those issues are not there. And yes, for a private practitioner, I must say it improves practice. Whatever conferences you see, all surgeons are doing surgery in the topical. Whatever premium surgeon you name on this earth, he will be doing surgery under topical. So mind you, take this up, do surgery under topical, or else you will stay behind. Yes, as an expert today, I would like to emphasize on this issue very important, that it's not that every case can be taken up by everyone. individual expertise will matter definitely, but there are few case scenarios where you have to put special caution. Mind you, whenever there are extremes of age, then coordination and cooperation both are not good. So you have to think of other types of anesthesia here. If you have an extra apprehensive patient, very much anxious, then yes, again, you might refrain from surgery under topical. If you have a hard of hearing patient with nystagmus, then the surgery under topical is not very easy. And if somebody directly tells you that he had a past experience with topical that wasn't very good, then no point emphasizing it again. You can do this time under retrovulvar or perivulvar, whatever. If you have a real deep set eye, that's very important, and you are adamant to sit superiorly, then surgery is not going to be very easy. So in deep set eyes, you might refrain from topical. And if you have any of the iris issues like synechia or non-dilating pupil, you want to use expanders or devices to dilate pupil, or you want to have an endocapsular ring or CTRs or something, Sion earrings or something like that with a subluxated cataract on table, then please don't do the case under topical. You have to see or have a reserve for perivulvars. Observe in your OPD who are office blinkers. Those are not very good candidates for topical, and see their cooperation on immersion biometry or action tonometry. If somebody is very anxious, not able to cooperate on that, then mind you, these patients are not going to be very cooperative on table under topical anesthesia. And to start with, you must select a grade 2 cataract in the beginning with a very clear cornea and very dilated pupil, so as to have an encouragement and positive reinforcement in your area. Many agents are available, but we emphasize, yes, proparathion drops 0.5%, that's enough for anesthesia. Now, important part is how to counsel the patient for topical. Best is to show two videos, two surgeries happening side by side on one computer screen, and the patient will automatically pick it up that yes, this is going to be very lucrative and very easy, and I will opt for that. And yes, while doing the surgery, don't you give so many instructions. Let the patient feel that you are confident. Your confidence, your sturdy hands, your confident statements give a lot of impact on the psyche of the patient. And ask the patient what he or she wants. If she frankly says, put an injection in my eye, just please give. Don't unnecessarily tax the lady. And yes, when you do the surgery, ask the patient to keep the eyes relaxed, wide open and fixating at the light. Don't ask the patient to look here and there. Lesser the instructions, it is going to be better. Keep talking to the patient for two reasons. First, they are diverted. They don't anticipate something stressful happening with them. And yes, often I have observed patients do sleep. Yes, patients sleep during the surgery, and one fine moment, a sudden jerk will come and they will shift their head. So avoid that thing to happen with you, and just keep talking on the daily routine questions. How many children you have? Where have you been educated? Where do you live? Who has come with you as attendant in the hospital? Such questions are very helpful and very easy to answer and keep the patient connected with you. It is very easy when the other eye is open. Mind you, if the patient closes the other eye with the bells, his other eye goes up. And with that, bells is a bilateral phenomenon. The other eye, the operating eye, will also tend to go up. So if you ask the patient to open the other eye and you don't drape it, just open it. And ask the patient to see the ceiling from the non-operating eye. If this thing happens, then the opening of the operated eye becomes easy. Teach the difference between touch and pain. When you start the surgery, touch the eye with one instrument and say, see, I am touching you. You are feeling that something has touched you, but it is not pain. So don't prompt me and don't point out that it is paining. If you get a genuine pain, then only tell, this touch will keep happening and this is normal. So the patient will not be apprehensive. Whenever you are going to do such steps which are going to stretch the eyeball, like hydration, like IOL injection, or you are going to put in a suture, prompt the person that you will feel some stretch. Or you can divert. Immediately ask, today who has come with you in the hospital? The moment he thinks and answers, just do that step. In the while, the moment in which he is answering, that time will be, that 1 second will be enough for you to get that step done. So that is one way out I do, and you might practice that way. If you are a resident surgeon, the best time to adopt topical is that very time. Just learn that way. Just imagine that this is the normal way to do surgery. and your eyes see only what the mind is prepared to comprehend. I must pay attributes even today to Professor Sanjeev Gupta. He taught me paper classification, and the very first case I did was under topical, and till date I am doing it under topical. So adopting topical as resident is the best way. And if you are a switching surgeon, just remove this mental block. It's never the age which can stop you. At any age you can shift. You can see multiple videos, and yes, give one block. Don't give block to both the eyes and practice. If you have a seasoned surgeon with you, then it is better. Just do some steps. Just put an IUL someday, just make a Rexis someday under topical, and one fine day you will feel that yes, now I'm mature enough to do the full case under topical. And once you are switching from block to topical, I would humbly suggest to shift from superior to temporal. Eye opening is better, you get a better field of view, and less of complications would be there if you shift from block to topical and from superior to temporal. Draping is the foundation of surgery, and this is a very short video I would like to show here for draping. See, the light is not there on the eye, and see, both the eyes are open. Now putting a swab stick, taking the eyes up, eyes down and lids up, and this is how the drape is being put, and now drape is being opened. See, the drape is fully out, and then I'm going to cut the drape. Not a single lash is out in the field. The whole lashes are sticking to the drape, and the speculum is now being placed, and now you will see that light is being thrown onto the eye. So this is the ideal way to prepare the case. And now, as the case is prepared, I would request Dr. Navendu to tell how good a surgical phaco can be done under topical. So I thank you all for your attention, and now ask the other participant, Dr. Navendu, to take up. Thank you.
Dr. Mohit, that was a wonderful compilation of tricks and tips for anyone to switch to phaco under topical anesthesia rather any other surgery. And I'll also add that what Dr. Mohit suggested, that when you start doing surgery and learning surgery, you use topical anesthesia, and this may sound very counterintuitive because most of the training centers, they allow only under local anesthesia. So yeah. Now I'll invite Dr. Navendu, who will explain that why and how we should switch to topical for phacoemulsification, which is the most common surgery today performed. And it is very important that one should switch to topical to remain competitive in the present situation for your patients.
Thank you very much, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. At the outset, I would like to thank Professor Dr. Sanjeev Gupta, sir, for giving me a chance to be a part of this wonderful insertion course. Because this is something that initially in my practice, I used to be very, apprehensive. How and why should I switch from local to topical anesthesia? So this is something that I have been through. And so I'll be taking you through this journey. That how I started, because I was doing cataract surgeries and all the surgeries in block. It was because Sanjeev sir has been my co-guide during my MS days. I was always in touch with sir. Whenever I got a chance to visit Lucknow, I used to speak to him, I used to visit him, that what is the new that he's been doing nowadays. And he always pushed me, why don't you switch over from local to topical? So slowly, I got that confidence by visiting his OTs. So how to shift, I'll now go ahead with that. And what are the questions that come in our mind while we think about switching from local to topical? What are the advantages? Why? What is the feel for the need of this topical anesthesia? What is a mental block that we need to be talking about? What is the learning curve for the topical anesthesia? What are the hurdles that are faced, and how do we manage them? Learning to cope up with the anxiety of the patient. Dr. Mohit sir has very well demonstrated this in his talk, that how to cope up with the anxiety of the patient. And finally, we want a happy patient and a happy doctor. That is our ultimate goal. So what are the advantages of topical anesthesia? The disadvantages of local anesthesia, they become the advantages for the topical anesthesia. So the risk associated with needle injections are positive pressure, posterior pressure, iris prolapse, choroidal hemorrhage, retinal detachment, postoperative diplopia, optic nerve injury, misdirection of anesthesia into the subarachnoid knot space or even to an artery. These are the potential complications that can occur with a retrobulbar block, which most of us, we don't have that. But just to mention, these are the risk associated with needle injections. So, and on the other hand, now the expectation of patients has increased because with time, the patient wants you to improve. The expectations increase. Now, how to cope up with them? You need something new. And this new thing comes without any expenditure. So that the patient wants immediate results without pain, without downtime, and often without sutures. The advantages of keeping the cornea wet and lubricated is there from the moment the surgery is complete. From a patient's perspective, visual recovery is rapid, eliminating the need for a patch after surgery. An early application of eye drops postoperatively that help prevent complications and improve surgical outcomes. These are the advantages of topical anesthesia over the retrobulbar anesthesia. Now, what is the feel for need? Is it peer pressure? Definitely, because most of the surgeons in town now are doing phaco on the topical anesthesia. So you have this peer pressure and you feel the need for this shifting. Patients demand, yes, of course. My first case, I will tell you all, my first case was because of patient's demand. I'll come to that later on. And the need to upgrade. As I told you, this is the upgradation with minimal or no expenditure at all. So my first patient was a very close friend's mother who was operated under topical anesthesia at Lucknow. She is diabetic. She was not able to travel now because of some problems in her leg. So she wanted to get the cataract surgery done locally, and I was her preferred surgeon. But the only thing was she didn't want the cataract surgery to be done under local anesthesia because she had already experienced what are the benefits of topical anesthesia. So that was the pressure and the patient's demand that made a need to get myself upgraded. There was a mental block, as I had, everybody has that mental block. So how can we switch over from this mental block? That is by discussing with colleagues doing topical phaco. Sanjeev sir was the first person and the one who I have been troubling again and again to clear my doubts how to switch from local to topical. Mohit boss is second one. So I always used to discuss with them what are the steps in which you get these problems and how to overcome them. Then I started watching videos of all the prominent surgeons who do for phaco on the topical anesthesia. I have also attended Sanjeev sir's OT, attending OTs of surgeons proficient in topical phaco that I have done. I have been to OTs of Dr. Sanjeev Gupta whenever I had a chance to visit Lucknow. So that this is how I overcome my mental block. Then the first case, as Mohit boss has already told us about this, the patient should be very cooperative. He should be willing to go on the topical anesthesia. The other eye has not operated under block. Because the other eye has been operated under block, he will be comparing the pain sensitivity with the eye operated in block, and definitely initially you will have problems with that. The patient who is not an office squeezer, Dr. Mohit has already told us. The nuclear grade, not too soft, not too hard. Otolith should not be long. The surgeon should be at ease. If the otolith is very long, the surgeon is already under pressure. So you should be at ease. Dim the illumination while you are draping. Supplement with the local anesthesia whenever it is required. And initially, when you are starting the surgery, treat both the eyes with topical proparacaine. So what is the learning curve associated with this? Initially, you select cooperative patients. Then your experience increases, you become more proficient in doing topical phaco, you become fearless. And you start doing topical phaco in all the patients. Now, then you get one presumed cooperative patient and a complication occurs. That shatters your confidence and you are back to blocks. But once you are back to blocks now you are a experienced surgeon. So you don't have to start from scratch. your experienced surgeon, now you can slowly and steadily start the cases again and slowly, slowly build up your practice on the topical anesthesia. What are the hurdles faced? What should be the, my method of topical anesthesia? Will it be a jelly or an intracameral lignocaine? Believe me, both of them work. Now I'm doing under, initially I used to do under jelly, and now I'm doing under intracameral lignocaine, and I feel that intracameral lignocaine is better. The most important step is doing CCC, because after that, both your instruments are inside and the patient cannot move. So during CCC, you have to be very cautious, and you should tell the patient that now the step I'm going to do requires some cooperation. And a cooperative patient suddenly sometimes becomes uncooperative, so you need to talk to them timely. Patch or no patch is your own choice. There are some surgeons who want to patch. I don't patch. And when to start inserting eye drops postoperatively, because I'm not patching, I'm starting it instantaneously. The first drop is put on the table itself. The steps in FACO requiring special attention are disinfection initially, insertion of eyelid speculum, microscope light, corneal incision, starting facial emulsification and IOL insertion. These are the steps which we need to be very cautious, and we should be talking to the patient at that time, because we know that if the patient is not looking towards the light, or he's moving his eye here and there, then these are the steps in which we can have problem. I will be showing you one video. This is my first video, first case. You can see that the patient is not very cooperative. This was my first case, and you can see that even the draping has not been done properly, because this was my first case. So, and I'll just show you initially during the CCC itself, because the patient was not very cooperative, and I had chosen a wrong case. So what happens? The rexis extends. So now I am going to do the part of the rexis will be done as can opener one. What after that, after doing completing it with a can opener style, I will be collapsing the nucleus in the anterior chamber. You can see this, the nucleus has been collapsed in the anterior chamber. And then the FACO was done in the anterior chamber. Putting visco again and again. A coercive viscoelastic was put initially itself. And finally, the case looks like this. So we have finished with the case. So this was my first case. And believe me, first case will be a problem with you, but you start doing it. So surgical outcome depends on the patient cooperation. The most uncooperative amma becomes cooperative just by talking to her. Keep talking to the patient about topics not related to surgery, as Mohit sir already told us. Whom not to take under topical anesthesia, the young anxious patients not cooperative during indirect arthroscopy or a scan, patient who has other eye surgery under block, cases in which you anticipate complications like PPC, PEX, I mean pseudoexposure syndrome, very small pupil, etc. Ultimate goal is a successful surgeon and a happy patient. Thank you.
Dr. Navindu, that was a very, very honest presentation, in the sense that you not only guided all the audience, but also shared your first experience. In fact, you said that video, which was your first surgery.
Sir, I would like to add one thing. Yes. Why should we switch over from local to topical? Initially, I was doing SICS and FACO almost in similar numbers. So almost about 50-50. But once I started doing FACO under topical, I did not switch over in SICS. So I was doing SICS under block. So what happened? Most of the Ammajis, they started switching from SICS to the package that I had and the topical FACO. So that was the switch. And obviously, because financially, there is not much difference in the expenditure of SICS and FACO, we all know. But the switch, it becomes, better for us if you are in a private practice. And now that I do also almost 99.9% topical FACO.
That also emphasizes that how much important it is for that patient to have that experience, which is painless as far as anesthesia delivery is concerned, and equally painless as compared to local anesthesia when doing under topical. So it is a patient experience which will definitely give you numbers.
Yes, sir.
Now we will switch to Dr. Rajat Mohan Srivastava. and he will further our journey of this topical anesthesia by extending
this.
Sir,
I had a comment to make about Dr. Naveen's presentation.
Yes, boss.
Yes, please.
Yeah. So specifically, the video that you showed was like it was not an ideal case to be performing phacoemulsification. It was a mature cataract. Then secondly, when you encounter an extended rexus, again, that would be criteria for conversion to probably SICS for a beginner. And then you are doing it under topical anesthesia. You also say that it is your first case. So by and large, that was a mistake, and you are very lucky to be through with it.
Yes,
without
sir.
Complications.
So actually, as I told you in the beginning itself, that my first case was a forced one. That was my very close friend's mother. She was a diabetic.
See, all the more reason. All the more reason you have added another comorbid condition. Being a VIP is a special condition. It puts additional pressure on the surgeon.
Yes, sir.
So that was something which should be
avoided. Sometimes we need to join hands in front of him and go ahead. That was that case for me.
if it was a VIP with this kind of a cataract, I would have probably done an SICS and got away with it. Probably the repeatability of the procedure and need for God to intervene to save me would be slightly lesser.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Doctor.
Yes,
Doctor
yes,
Gupta,
all in all, it was a good presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
So I will now invite Dr. Rajat Mohan Srivastava, and he will further this journey of topical anesthesia by extending its application to trabeculectomy. Over to Dr. Rajat.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Sanjeev, sir, for giving me this opportunity. And also, my thanks to the AOS for giving me this opportunity to present this presentation on trabeculectomy under topical anesthesia. So one thing we need to understand is that topical anesthesia has become a need for cataract surgeon because the incision size has been going on smaller and smaller. So the safety of the surgery has increased because even if there are movements which happen in cataract surgery, they really don't make much of a difference because the entry size of the wound is too small. We have moved to almost 1.8 now. So topical anesthesia for cataract surgery is almost like a norm today. But when it comes to trabeculectomy under topical anesthesia, yes, there are limitations. We do understand that for any anesthesia, there are certain objectives which you want to fulfill. We want to have that patient should have a painless experience. At the same time, we should not face problem because of ocular movement. So echinesia is always useful. And it is always better that the patient forgets all surgical experience, so he is always happy after the surgery. But what we need to emphasize upon that whenever we are choosing for anesthesia for any procedure, we need to weigh between the safety of the procedure, surgeon experience of the surgery, and the eventual outcome. So we need to strike a balance between the safety profile and a comfortable surgeon with the outcome. And if we are able to do that, most of the time we'll be achieving good results with the right anesthesia for that particular surgery. In trabeculectomy, yes, optic nerve is already damaged, and we know there are complications which can happen to optic nerve with retrobulbar and peribulbar injections. So sometimes to have an alternative is a need for trabeculectomy. In the past, we have been often using general anesthesia for people who really cannot afford to have a retrobulbar or a peribulbar block because of extensive damage to the optic nerve and the chances of having a wipeout phenomenon. So we often resorted to general anesthesia, but general anesthesia in all the settings are not possible. So then in those settings, again, where you have got advanced disease and you really cannot afford retrobulbar, peribulbar anesthesia. Those are the cases where you need to have an alternative, and a topical anesthesia is often a choice in those cases, which as a surgeon, as a glaucoma specialist, one should have an experience with topical anesthesia. So whenever a need arises, it can be done. But trabeculectomy itself is a procedure which is laden with complication, not only post-operative, but also intraoperative. And if we have another step which can enhance the rate of complication in form of retrobulbar, peribulbar injection, it is best avoided. But then we really didn't know if this thing is going to work. But in early 21st century, there have been studies where after the phacoemulsification was becoming a common practice under topical anesthesia, phacotrabeculectomy had also been tried under topical anesthesia, and slowly and gradually it was seen with various studies that topical anesthesia trabeculectomy was a new reality. I mean, now with time, I'm sure it is going to become a very common place, just like cataract surgery. But yes, it is on the horizon. It is becoming new reality for all the glaucoma surgeons that they can go ahead with topical anesthesia without compromising on patient experience, surgeon comfort, and the outcome. In fact, a lot of studies have even shown that if we compare topical anesthesia with peribulbar, retrobulbar anesthesia, and trabeculectomy, they more or less have the same outcomes, and patient experience has also been good. And at the same time, the chances of complication associated with injections are reduced. But when it comes to a surgeon, you know, when you have to move as a glaucoma surgeon, if somebody has to move to topical, obviously there are so many doubts which we have. How are we going to manage the ocular movement? How are we going to see that we have adequate exposure? Patient is anxious because he's already aware that, okay, now I have to undergo surgery. The disease is advanced. It is not getting controlled with medication. And what about pain? Because he has experienced pain in the past. He's having some allergies, some form of complication which is preventing him from continuing medical medication. So topical anesthesia, it becomes a challenge even for a patient to decide for whether he'll be able to manage, undergo the surgery, and also for the surgeon as well, because of so many complications which are usually associated with trabeculectomy. But as has been pointed out previously, the biggest thing is the mental block. Now, if you are a surgeon who is competent to perform trabeculectomy under peribulbar anesthesia or retrobulbar anesthesia with good confidence, I think you can. I mean, I would say a surgical load case of say at least 100 surgeries in the past you have done, and you are good at making flaps and performing your trabeculectomy routinely, then I think you can. One can think of shifting to topical anesthesia as well. That can be augmented with intracameral anesthesia or sometimes even with subconjunctival conjunctival anesthesia if required. Now, to achieve the desired success, it has been very well emphasized in previous talk that you need to have the right patient selection. There is no point having someone who is not cooperative. If a person cannot hear you, doesn't understand you, person cannot fixate anywhere, often happens in trabeculectomy, or a person with head nodding movements, or because most of these patients are old, sometimes neurological illnesses are there, and even hearing loss. All these things make patient very uncomfortable when they are undergoing for surgery. They are not able to cooperate with you. At the same time, obesity, diabetes status, or some COPD, which can affect the draping of the patient for the surgery, can again be a problem. And then if you want to have a good cooperative patient, you cannot afford sedation. So that again becomes a problem. So when it comes to selecting a patient, you need to have a patient who is, say, moderate to severe glaucoma with good fixation and is able to understand you. And you know that eyes, it is a possibility to have good exposure without compromising any other tissues. So when it comes to surgeon, there has to be adequate proficiency for performing for surgery. You need to have confidence. You need to overcome you need to have belief that it can be done, first of all. And when you're doing surgery, because the eye has to be in downward gait for most of the time of the surgery, it is often good to give breaks to the patient where the patient can look down in between so that he gets a break and you can perform the surgery. And with the anesthesia, with the bulbar block, with the retrobulbar and peribulbar block gone, you get good conjunctiva without chemosis to work upon, which is very, very necessary when it comes to glaucoma surgery. So with right patient selection and having good understanding of your own abilities, you can go ahead performing a good trabeculectomy and achieve the desired result. I'll just share one of the videos which I have got from my chief instructor. This is Professor Sanjeev Gupta demonstrating one of these trabeculectomy under topical surgery. So it's a limbus-based procedure. And you can see with the cooperative patient, when the patient is looking down, how good is the exposure without the superior rectus traction. And with the superior rectus traction gone, so many other complications which can happen because of it are actually gone. I mean, superior rectus brittle, if one doesn't have to take, it becomes so easy. One of the things which is missing here is that when we do a diathermy, even if we do light diathermy, that doesn't cause much of a pain. And a few drops of topical anesthesia here and there does the purpose. You have to be very gentle and careful while holding this flap. And this is the time where I'm telling you that you need to give those wriggle breaks to the patient, where you can just leave the flap and ask the patient to look down. At this point of time, intracameral injection of lignocaine helps. Not only does it reduce the pain associated with performing iridectomy, it makes the overall experience good for the patient. You can at the same time, you can make a side port entry, which will help us in titrating the bleb when it comes to. You can see the amount of bleed is less just because of one inadvertent injury to the blood vessel. There is slight chemosis. Otherwise, it is very good. Look at the conjunctiva. I mean, absolutely no chemosis anywhere. So this kind of conjunctiva is going to give very good end results when we follow up these patients later. And in fact, in one of the studies where they have compared the long-term outcomes with topical anesthesia have been equally good compared to peribulbar anesthesia. So we see that the patient is happy with all ocular movement, no pain, and a relatively safe surgery performed in these cases. So trabeculectomy under topical anesthesia is definitely a reality, which should be encouraged in patient because it is not about your own choice. There are times when it is a need for patient, especially in those advanced cases. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. And thank you, sir, again for giving me this opportunity and the video. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Raja, that was very convincing. And I hope few of our audiences may go ahead and try this. It will be increasing the safety of the procedure and the safety of the glaucoma progression as far as the IOP rise associated with the local anesthesia is concerned. Now I'll be talking about the Trojan horse anesthesia. This is a modified or augmented topical anesthesia which can be used for past plena vitrectomy. And I've been using this technique for quite some time now. Rather, I have one publication also credited to this technique. So the context is that, as we all have discussed and we are very well aware, that topical anesthesia is a choice for phacoemulsification in routine, and here we are sitting here and trying to extend the horizon by incorporating other surgeries as well. So we'll see how can we do this vitrectomy and the topical anesthesia. Now there's a sort of small background story here that I was operated a patient for cysticercosis, and then there was some leak from one of the sclerostomies because it was a sutureless surgery. And then next day I had to augment some IOP plus I had to put a suture. So I thought that putting in some amount of lignocaine would help in anesthetizing the patient. I didn't do it under local anesthesia because it was just a scleral suture. So then the patient claimed that when he was going into the OT, he could see something, and when he came out, he couldn't see anything. And I was puzzled because I didn't do anything to the retina. But then I realized later on that probably in a vitrectomized eye, when I put in intracameral anesthesia, this solution must have percolated into the posterior cavity where the vitreous was missing, and the anesthesia went ahead and anesthetized the retina. So then I realized that this solution can actually anesthetize the retina as well as other tissue of the eye. And because there was a complete recovery the next day, as you can expect out of any local anesthesia. So I was convinced that this is a temporary anesthesia, which gives very good anesthetic effect, which lasts only for few hours. So I'm sharing these images of this patient who underwent vitrectomy and followed by intravitreal lignocaine injection. So after having that experience, I thought of using intracameral lignocaine as a tool to anesthetize to the ciliary body, the pars plana, because these structures are lying very close to the zonules. So I expect if I put in some amount of lignocaine as we use intracameral anesthesia and wait for time to percolate it down and anesthetize the pars plana also. So we devised this study where we had selected patients undergoing vitrectomy for various reasons, but excluding retinal detachment, because there we would like to see indent and see peripheral retina for possibility of any break. So we excluded those patients and we graded the pain sensation as per the visual analog scale. And these are the results. So there are 114 eyes and majority of them were males. The surgical time was about a half an hour and the pain perceived was on a range of 0 to 9, it was 3. And the range of the pain perceived by all the patients was 0 to 8 and median was 3. And 100, that is 87.7% patients who opted for the same technique, same anesthesia, again, if they are supposed to be operated again. And the pain scores were not affected by the age or gender or educational status of the subject or indications of surgery and the use of silicone oil in case we had to put in silicone oil for any indication. So I had this experience and till then I have been using this technique in majority of my patients. Yes, I do have few selection criteria that I don't usually use this technique in patients in whom I have to do some kind of scleral indentation or in whom I plan to do endo laser or laser using LIO, because I believe that intracameral anesthesia will not percolate into the vitreous cavity till it has had a vitrectomized eye. So I don't expect retina to get anesthetized till we have an empty vitreous cavity. And very important thing here is that one should wait for at least 2 to 3 minutes once you have injected intracameral lignocaine in the anterior chamber. And make sure that when you are injected, just let some aqueous seep out so that the intracameral anesthesia agent, which is used in a concentration of 1%, doesn't get further diluted by the aqueous. So you let the aqueous drain out, inject intracameral anesthesia, and then look at your clock. Give it some time to percolate and anesthetize the ciliary body and pars plana. And then when you start with your scleroscopies, which is supposedly the most painful procedure, use a trocar cannula set so that repeated entry and exit doesn't disturb the pars plana. And in cases, you can start with a situation where you have a media clearing surgery to be done without much manipulation needed. And this will build up your confidence. And about the utility for the patient, I feel that not only the experience would be less painful, but patients have also reported, especially in cases with media opacity where I'm doing it for vitreous hemorrhage, patients have reported gain in vision immediately after surgery. Although the gain further continues and you have better vision next day, but even after the surgery, they can perceive this change. And you can let the patient off without any patch because the muscles, the ocular movements, the lid, they all are working fine. So the conclusion of my talk is that this is possible, that we can use, now I have used the word Trojan horse here because this is something like a legend, which is supposedly in a battle, it was found that because the attacking army could not breach the walls of the fort, so they left behind a horse filled with some soldiers inside. So it was an artifact left behind, and the people inside the fortress, they thought that this is just a souvenir left to them. They pulled it inside, and during the night time, the soldiers, they came out and they opened the door. So I have named it accordingly, that you let lignocaine go inside from one door and it will disarm the sensation and the pain sensation of the ciliary body pars plana. And then you can go ahead and create sclerostomies to reach into the vitreous cavity. So as per my experience and this study, I have concluded that this anesthesia provides adequate analgesia and it is safe for 23 gauge, which we have used in this particular study, with high patient acceptability. So I hope that this will spark some idea in your mind, and maybe that you will also try this in selected patients of yours. Thank you. So, now we have another speaker. We will talk about squint surgery under topical anesthesia. Now this appears a little far-fetched because traditionally we all have been convinced that intraocular structures are well anesthetized by topical anesthesia. But here we will have Dr. Siddharth Agarwal from our university. He is a strabismus and a pediatric ophthalmologist who will explain to us how and why to do strabismus surgery under topical anesthesia, which is so limited to the pediatric population. But let's hear him out. Dr. Siddharth, over to you.
Please unmute yourself.
Yeah, I've done that. So thank you, Dr. Sanjeev, for having me here. And the session is quite special to me as it has probably the most talented senior that I have come across and equally talented juniors. So I would be speaking on strabismus surgery under topical anesthesia, and seeing all the surgeries earlier, this should probably be the most painful considering the manipulation of the extraocular muscles that is involved in strabismus surgery. So about 3 to 4 years back, I was quite apprehensive about topical anesthesia, but gradually I've been doing strabismus surgery under topical anesthesia in a selected number of patients. So what is the situation in relation to strabismus surgery elsewhere? In the United States, most of the strabismus surgery is performed under general anesthesia for medical legal concerns related to analgesia and amnesia. In Singapore, it has been on for quite some time. There are plenty of reports, and gradually the acceptability is increasing elsewhere because there are some clear advantages which I discuss here. When we are doing adjustable surgeries, it allows adjustment on the table. You are able to ensure a diplopia-free primary gaze. And if the patient is under a block, this adjustment has to be done on the third bone. So a good number of patients of incomitant deviation or small angle deviations, we are able to perform the adjustment on the table with patients being under topical anesthesia. Similarly, when adjustable sutures are used, sometimes you have to titrate the correction, and this is also possible with greater ease under topical anesthesia. In bilateral surgeries, you don't want to patch both the eyes. So again, it has an advantage. And all the disadvantages of block go, such as chemosis and rise in the intraorbital pressure. It is obviously indicated in patients who are sensitive to xylocaine. Now, surgeons who have performed about 100 strabismus surgeries should be able to try this. And another criteria that I've added is that you need to be a reasonably experienced surgeon when you are upgrading to topical. For strabismus, it is about half an hour of surgical time for 2 muscle surgeries. If you take longer, then probably you need to first polish your skills more before you upgrade. regarding the patient, it should be a cooperative patient, preferably over 18 years of age, and should be willing to bear some pain. You can't promise a painless surgery, painless strabismus surgery, when you are performing surgery under topical anesthesia. It should be limited to horizontal muscle surgeries and initially only resections, because greater amount of manipulation is involved in resection surgery, which can be uncomfortable. And whenever you are performing adjustable or bilateral surgery, it has a clear advantage. With regards to modification in steps, preoperative use of xylocaine jelly and phenylephrine drops to reduce the vascularity. Intraoperatively, don't try the fornix incision. The paralimbal incision provides a wider exposure with minimal manipulation. Use xylocaine prior to hooking the muscle. There should be minimal manipulation. Pull on the muscle should be minimum. This you have to tell your assistant. Very often the muscles get pulled. So analgesia is ensured by xylocaine, but not the discomfort related to the pull on the muscle. Minimal cautery, and preferably heat cautery, because heat cautery is less uncomfortable compared to the electrocautery. And using tissue glue for conjunctival closure not only minimizes your surgical time, but also reduces the discomfort associated with manipulation of conjunctiva. Do not pull. Minimize the electrocautery. You should be confident about identification of the muscle. You can't be fishing for the muscle in a patient with who's under topical anesthesia. And an important point is that you have to connect the monitor, because oculocardiac reflex is often exaggerated in the absence of block. So specifically when you are dealing with the medial vectors. So although the patient is under topical anesthesia, the monitor should be connected in all patients who are being operated for strabismus. Now, this is a patient who underwent resection surgery for exotropia in the left eye, and I would be showing his video. Now, these are the initial traction sutures, which we proceed as usual. We would be giving the modified von Nudan incision to ensure a wide exposure. This is the recession of the lateral rectus muscle, which is being shown initially. The muscle is hooked with minimum manipulation. Heat cautery has been used, and then the muscle is anchored onto the 6-0 vicryl sutures. The muscle would now be disinserted and reattached at the recessed site. The conjunctiva is closed with fibrin glue. Now onto the resection. This is the medial rectus. One has to be extra careful while handling the medial rectus, because firstly, the space is slightly lesser. It is more painful, and there are greater chances of oculocardiac reflex. The muscle has been identified. Heat cautery would be done, and the muscle anchored. The stump is now removed, and the resected muscle sutured back onto the original insertion site. The middle suture is being given, and finally we reattach. The adhesions are severed, and we reattach the muscle. Reattach the conjunctiva with fibrin glue. Now, this is a small video to show the immediate post-operative mobility. And this is finally the response of the patient. So the pain is tolerable. You can't promise a pain-free surgery. Now, another patient of traumatic cataract with sensory esotropia, he underwent a topical phacoemulsification followed by sorry, the recession surgery is done first. So he underwent a medial rectus recession followed by topical phaconalsification in the same sitting. So thank you for a patient hearing, and I'm open to questions should there be any.
Oh, very nice, Dr. Siddharth, and you have not only explained how to do it, but also convinced me as well as the audience that this is possible. Although you have been also very practical in cautioning the issues related to pain and selection of patient. And I think it will help few of us to switch to topical anesthesia, looking at the advantages as per the given conditions. Now I'll proceed to my talk on manual small incision cataract surgery, why and how. So I'll be very quick in my slides because I want to emphasize more towards the surgical video, which I'll be sharing. So rest of the things are nearly same repetition of the same issues, which my previous speakers have already emphasized on. That a manual is small incision cataract surgery, which is a very popular technique among all of our cataract surgeons, is there for us to those patients in whom we cannot do phacoemulsification for various reasons. And it has been proven in literature as per few of publications, few of which are mine, that it is as painless as a topical phaco. And there are issues which should be taken care of, and the patient's experience is going to be wonderful. So the safety issue is all well known to all of us, that putting a needle in the orbit will have issues, which Dr. Mohit and Dr. Navindu has handled well. And there's a glamour associated with this patch, but it looks only good on few of the individuals, rather not all of us. So the patient would be liking to avoid it, and this is possible only if the ocular movements and lid movements are well preserved. And it has been very well advertised that no injection such surgery has an impact, as Dr. Navindu was telling. The patient's experience is a different one if he is not given local anesthesia. And how can we do this? So as with the rest of the surgeries, you have to be good at it, because you cannot take chances in making a mistake. Communicate with the patient and remove that mind block that it is not possible. So I'm just repeating the statement that manual small incision surgery is possible under topical anesthesia. Now proceeding to how do we do that? So I have few tips of my own, although these are all individual variations and people can experiment upon. I use specifically lignocaine 2% jelly in place of drops, and I believe that it has a longer contact time and a deeper anesthesia plus prolonged anesthesia, as per the formulation allows the contact time to be longer than drops only. And I will advise minimal surface handling, because as Dr. Mohit said, the touch and pain may not be differentiated by a few of our patients. And do use intracameral lignocaine starting. If you have very averse to lignocaine, putting any molecule in the anterior chamber, you may not use it later on, but starting, do use it. Rather, there's a comparative study in phacoemulsification on use of no intracameral anesthesia versus intracameral anesthesia for phacoemulsification patients. And it was very conclusive that patients with intracameral anesthesia do have comfortable experience, because the possibility of stretching the globe and handling the iris is always there during phacoemulsification. I will advise against using bipolar cautery, because the current which is causes a sensation which cannot be overcome by topical anesthesia. IOP rise and stretching of the globe should be avoided. And subconjunctival injections again cause some pain, so I usually avoid them. Now here we have a nice video where I'll show you. This is a recent video where you can see the surgeon has been planning a phacoemulsification in a very, very brown and hard cataract. And this is an initial shying away of the eye when intracameral anesthesia is injected, because the pH of the intracameral solution is little acidic. This is the formulation limitation, and it causes irritation of the iris. So patients would usually try to blink and have a protective reflex when you inject it. But over a period of time, the stinginess goes away, and now Rexis has been completed. And you will be surprised that I am showing you a video of phaecomb ossification, but just be patient and see. Now, during this phase, I realized that the bag is not very stable. So I decided to switch to manual small incision cataract surgery. And you, as you could guess, this patient was under topical anesthesia. A very, very light electrocautery is being used just to have control of the bleed. And the same incision of the phaecomb ossification has been extended further to incorporate a small incision cataract surgery tunnel and then enlarging the tunnel. So here I am able to also demonstrate that this is a useful technique. If you can actually have a situation where at some point of time you decide to switch to small incision cataract surgery, and if you are well versed with SICS and the topical anesthesia, you can do that. Now the rex is being extended because we need to deliver the nucleus, and you can see the nucleus is not very stable at the point. Now it's a large nucleus, it's a hard nucleus, and having unstable zone use adds to the trouble. Now this is a situation where you will not like to experiment with phaco, so it was a good choice on my behalf that I switched to SICS. It's a large nucleus. Nucleus has been delivered by a Fishhook technique. The IOL has been implanted, and you will see a twist here. Now there's some cortex left behind because I decided to implant the IOL and then go ahead with the irrigation aspiration. This burst of bubbles, which you will see now in slow motion, suddenly cause some fluctuation in that chamber, and we have a PC rent right here in this area. And the vitreous starts prolapsing. So it is, becomes a special case where the surgeon, in spite of taking extra caution, was unable to avoid a posterior capsular tear. And the, because the IOL is in the place, I don't want to disturb that. So I'm conservatively managing the vitreous strands and putting the air bubble in the chamber to stabilize and keep the vitreous away. So that was one surgery where I could demonstrate that you can have your desire of switching to small incision cataract surgery from phaecomb ossification, given a situation where you decide to do so for safety of the safety reasons or any other reason. And even in spite of having a complication, I could finish the surgery. So I'll just add one more thing about intracameral anesthesia, which I routinely use. It has been very well demonstrated in studies that intracameral anesthesia not only helps in anesthetizing the iris and ciliary body, it also helps in sustaining the midriasis. And it has been also known to help in floppy iris syndromes. So this is a great utility of topical anesthesia augmented with intracameral anesthesia. And as per various studies, putting 1% or 0.5% lignocaine in the anterior chamber doesn't cause any additional harm to the endothelium, which is supposedly the one of the most fragile tissue in the eye. So this finishes my talk, and I am willing to take any question for whole of my team if there are any.
So in the surgery you showed us, in the SICS one which was converted.
Yes, Mo.
So just, Navindu, yes. So just wanted to know, in the surgery that you showed us about the topical SICS which was converted into, topical phaco was converted into SICS, and then there was a rent. So in this case, if we don't manage the vitreous prolapse properly in the anterior chamber, is it going to be a problem in the early or late postoperative phase?
See, my philosophy for this situation is that you should manage that vitreous should not collapse into the wound. Now, I couldn't show you the whole of the procedure, but I did manage to constrict the pupil down to a size which was fairly less than 6 millimeters. And then if there's any prolapsing vitreous, which would be traveling through the pupil into the wound, it would definitely distort your pupil. So once you are sure that you don't have any vitreous peeking into the wound, there isn't going to be any issue. There will be no traction. There will be no irritation of the iris. And at the end, when I pushed in air, see, the issue was that one way to go was that I would have done a vitrectomy using a vitrectomy cutter and cleared the chamber, putting in triamcinolone, identifying vitreous. But then my concern was also that usually in a situation like that, if you go inside with a vitrectomy cutter, you may likely to actually damage the capsule, the remaining capsule. And which what I could see was that the IOL was perfectly sitting in the back and there's not much of the vitreous which was displacing. See, vitreous, if it would be there in great amount, it is going to displace your IOL inferiorly away from the site of PC rent. So I could judge that the vitreous is not disturbed to that extent that I had to go ahead and stain the vitreous and remove it. And the pupil was round after putting intracameral pilocarpine. And I could form the chamber nicely with air bubble, which kept the pupil round and kept the vitreous, any potential vitreous away. So I think it worked well for the patient also in post-operative phase. I was trying to find out a post-operative picture, but I couldn't. So I couldn't place it here, but he did fine. Rather, I would say that if I would have attempted a phacoemulsification and if he was destined to have a PC rent, then I would have been in a bigger mess with a hard nucleus and a large nucleus with a PC rent in the situation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. That solves my query.
So over to Dr. Prakash, who will be explaining how to proceed with phacoemulsification in incomplete capsulorhexis. So these are all complicated situations and we all need to learn something out of these.
Sir, my skin is visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, at the outset, I would like to thanks to Professor Sanjeev and AIOS Scientific Committee to give me the opportunity to share this platform. I'll be talking on phacoemulsification in ice with incomplete rhexis.
Sorry to stop you, Dr. Prakash. Have you shared your screen?
Yeah, it's not visible.
No, it's not visible.
सर मैं यहाँ से प्ले कर दूँ आपकी वीडियो
नाउ इज इट विजिबल नाउ
यस सर
सो दो एंट्री कैप्सुल टियर इज रिलेटिवली अनकॉमन कॉम्प्लिकेशंस ऑकर्स इन लेस देन 1% ऑफ फैकोएमल्सिफिकेशन प्रोसीड्योर एज मेंशन इन द लिटरेचर इट इज हाईली कंसर्न एज इट मे कॉज सम पोटेंशियल कॉम्प्लिकेशंस लाइक पोस्टीरियर कैप्सुल रेंट विट्रस लॉस एंड न्यूक्लियस ड्रॉप व्हेन द tear extends beyond the equator. The anterior capsule tear may be primary, which occurs prior to hydro dissection. It may be secondary that occurs after the completion of capsulorhexis. It was a white intumescent cataract here. You can see there is that tear extends to the periphery spontaneously in both directions due to the high interlenticular pressure, which is popular as Argentinian flag sign. It was a white cataract with anterior capsular fibrosis. Making a complete rhexis with anterior capsular fibrosis is challenging. Here we can see the rhexis is incomplete superiorly. It was a young myopic patients. In young myopic patients, the capsules are very elastic in nature. Here we can see the rhexis run into periphery just before joining. It was also white cataract. Rhexis was complete, but during rotations of the nucleus, the rhexis ran out. It was a hard cataract. I was doing single level vertical chopping, and due to excessive separating forces that transmitted to the capsular back causes radial tear of the anterior capsules superiorly. So by doing the multi-level chopping, we can avoid these complications. In this technique, first bury the phaco probe into the superficial part of the group, initiate a crack, then rewire the phaco probe to the deeper part, and by moving the chopper vertically and laterally, we can divide the nucleus completely, and we can also reduce the stress on the capsular back. It was also hard cataract. During fragment removal, there is a tear in the rhexis in inferiorly. So I mobilize the remaining lens fragments, then implant the IOL into the back as the IOL escape hole. then remove the remaining lines from the Thakupu and the McPherson forceps. Here we can see the axis tears occurs during the removal of cortex due to the excessive backwards movements of the aspiration probe. Here we can see the axis tears occurs during implantation of the IOL into the back. So, and here the axis tears occurs during the removal of ovary from the back of the IOL from the capsular back. So we have seen that axis tear occurs at any stage of the procedure, starting from the capsular axis up to the removal of OBD. And the further management of the anterior tear depends on the surgeon's experience, type of the cataract, location and timing of the tear, and the options are conversion to extracapsular extraction, anterior chamber phacoemulsification, and endocapsular phacoemulsifications. Endocapsular phacoemulsification still can be possible with good success with some surgical paths. First, convert the split anterior capsule into the circular H mass as possible to reduce the tractions of the remaining capsular support. And the hydrodecision should be performed very gently and carefully. I prefer to do judicious multi-quadrant hydrodecision every time I inject very small amount of fluid, and after every inject, decompress the nucleus. Excessive injections of fluid is try to avoid, otherwise it may cause collapse of the nucleus forwards and that may cause extensions of the tear. Rotate the nucleus very carefully to avoid traction on capsular runout. Enough deep sculpting is the prerequisites to divide the nucleus, and it is wise to use more ultrasounds. Here I am using 70% torsional ultrasound to avoid stress on the zonules, but I am using very low aspiration flow rate so that there is less chance to trauma to the posterior capsules. It is very critical to divide the nucleus completely to emulsify the fragments into the posterior plane. Here I am using a stop and chop technique. I am using the high beacom for better grip, better holding power, but I am using very low aspiration flow rate so that there is less chance to catch the posterior capsules. During fragment removal, it is very important to use optimal fluidic parameter to maintain the stability of the anterior chamber so that to prevent the peripheral extension of the tear. So we have to always keep in mind the output must be matched with the input, and slow motion phaco with torsional ultrasound is great to deal the cataract with incomplete axis, because with torsional ultrasound there is a minimal repulsions and there is no conflict between the energy and aspiration, and it greatly enhances the followability to bring the lens planar close to the phacotic, which is very important to deal with this cataract with incomplete axis. Repeated injection of dispersive OBD is a good idea to take care of corneal endothelium. The dispersive OBD has more negative molecular charge than the cohesive OBD, which is better absorbed by the positively charged corneal endothelium. This is also equally important to take care of posterior capsules. We have two options. One is a step-down technique, another is IOL scaffold. In a step-down technique, when more and more lens fragment is removed, the posterior capsule is gradually become unprotected. So it is wise to progressively reduce all parameters proportionally to take care of posterior capsule, which is described by Dr. Abhayar Basavada. In IOL scaffold technique, first maneuver the remaining lens fragments of the iris. Then I proceed to implant the IOL into the back through the existing corneal incisions. And then after injecting some dispersive OVD over the remaining lens fragments, I remove the remaining lens fragments with the phacoprobe. Here, I first implant the IOL into the back, and the remaining lens fragments are very hard. And so I remove it with the visco compressions and McPherson forceps to avoid the ultrasound induced trauma to the corneal endothelium. It is also important to inject OVD before removal of instrument from the main port to maintain the stability of the anterior chamber to prevent extensions of the axis tear. Phlegm motility is a very useful sign, which is described by Dr. Rohitam Prakash, by which we can assess the peripheral extensions of the tear. If the flat is inverted and fluttering, it indicates the tear is pre-equatorial, so we can continue phaco. But if it is inverted and non-fluttering, it indicates the tear extends beyond the equator. In that case, it is not wise to do continue phaco, and it is better to convert into the SICS. Removal of cortex by minimal IA is more effective than the coaxial IA. to remove the cortex in a controlled manner. And it is wise to first remove the cortex away from the rexistia, then remove the cortex around the rexistia, and it is wise to remove the cortex in a tangential manner, so and very carefully. A single piece foldable IOL can be implanted into the back very safely, and but the haptics oriented should be perpendicular to the rexistia for better IOL centration and to prevent the IOL dislocations. It also here we can see rexis is incomplete and there is a PC tear during the fragment removal. So I implant the dispersive OBD through the side port to tamponate the bitters. Then I take out my phaco probe. Then I proceed to implant a multi-piece IOL into the sulcus to prevent drop of the remaining lens fragments posteriorly. As the IOL, it will act as IOL scaffold. I gently rotate into the sulcus and the remaining lens fragments is removed with the visco compression and McPherson forceps. And I, as you can see, there's a last tear and I take a one bite. It is very important to remove the thorough removal of OBD to prevent postoperative rise of intraocular pressure. And it is wise to keep the bottle height initially low because already some bit OBD is there to prevent anterior chamber pressure. So when more and more OBD is removed, then gradually increase the bottle height. And removal of OBD can also from the back of the aisle very carefully. Thank you so much for patient's hearing.
So now we have come to the conclusion of this particular session, including the keynote address by Dr. Prakash. And I'll close this session. I'm requesting the hall coordinator to allow me to close.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. We have 8 minutes to go. If you want to summarize, anyone wants to comment, so we can. We have 8 minutes to go.
Okay. So I'll ask Dr. Siddharth to share his experience.
Yes, sir.
About Dr. Siddharth, are you there?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Dr. Siddharth, can you share your experience with your phacoemulsification and topical anesthesia and also some concluding remarks?
Yeah. So so phacoemulsification per se is a, I can't call it a simple surgery, but it is a repeatable surgery. If you have been doing it for a certain period of time and a good number of cases, it kind of is simpler than driving, because the uncertainties you face while driving in a crowded market are probably more than those that you face while operating on in an eye. It would appear to be an oversimplification, but with experience, I feel that I am more cautious while driving in a crowded market and more concentrating, and rather than when I'm operating a pre-planned and previously well-seen and worked up patient of cataract. So coming to the topical aspect of it, if you are like confident in your surgery, what I've also told you during my presentation on strabismus, you have to be a quick surgeon. You can't be lingering on for each step and then expect that the patient would be cooperative under topical anesthesia. I slightly differ from Dr. Sanjeev, who says that right from the training level, the student may learn his first surgery under topical anesthesia, because I feel that's a bit unfair on the patient. If you have an expert supervisor who's standing next to you on the assistant tube, then probably, yes, he would be speeding up the procedure, not taking long. But per se, you should not be spending more than 30 to 40 minutes in your initial phacoemulsifications.
when you are doing them under topical anesthesia. And for a beginner, what I've seen amongst the trainees is that the usual time that they take to complete a cataract surgery varies between 1 hour and 1.5 hours. So once your time comes down, you are confident with the step, you don't need to revisit your step each time. Once you've made an incision, you don't need to recheck it. That is the time you should probably be graduating to topical surgery, because the patient comfort is prime. And if you are taking too long being covered, the face covered, it gets quite claustrophobic if you imagine yourself in that situation. Once you start doing topical, then you are gradually getting more and more confident. So initially it would be something like a clean case, you proceed with topical surgery. Where you have a comorbid condition, you proceed with your usual surgery. Comorbid conditions, as you graduate, maybe you are able to handle one comorbid condition. So one comorbid condition could be a hard nucleus or a non-dilating pupil, or as a beginner, it could be the left eye of the patient. We all have realized that operating the right eye is easier. So as you graduate in your surgery, initially it would be that managing a clean case with no comorbid condition, gradually you would be able to manage one and two and three as you evolve as a surgeon. So that's right. It from my side, sir.
So I would like to add one point, sir. Whenever we are doing any ocular procedure, one of the things we need to understand and emphasize upon while choosing the type of anesthesia is that our choice for anesthesia should not trivialize the procedure which is being done. Because often when you go for a topical anesthesia, what goes into the mind of patient, okay, it's a very routine and okay kind of surgery with least complications. So you are in a process where you just trivialize the procedure altogether. We need to understand and emphasize upon the patient as well that yes, we are using a topical choice because it is going to be comfortable, but it doesn't really make the surgery a magic. Because often when you go for a topical anesthesia, people tend to underestimate the gravity of any surgical procedure which is being done. And here we need to reemphasize is that yes, the choice of surgery is only to enhance the comfort level of patient and the surgeon, but doesn't really make the choice, the procedure a trivial procedure. That is all I want to emphasize. Was I audible?
Yes, you were audible.
So topical should not really trivialize the procedure which we are doing.
So Dr. Gupta, can we take a last comment from you? We have 2 minutes to go. I think Dr. Gupta left. Dr. Khatri, you want to summarize?
Okay, so that was great. And under the able leadership of Professor Sanjeev Gupta and senior Dr. Prakash from Chittagong enlightening us for some situations in cataract surgery. So we have come to the end of this session, and it was great to see young surgeons like Dr. Navendu and then wisdom of Dr. Siddharth telling about experiences in PECO and experiences in strabismus. So that was a good conglomerate of different opinions coming up. And yes, I would just give one concluding remark that individual confidence and individual expertise is going to finally decide as what procedure and under what kind of anesthesia we are going to carry out the surgery. It's not a dictum that this surgery has to be done under topical or this surgery has to be done under block. One surgeon should give or accomplish a satisfied post-op patient. The aim is to have a satisfied post-op patient and get a successful surgery done, not just to prove a point that we have done it under topical. So it is always better to weigh the circumstances and know the limitations of our own surgical set and then decide that what type of anesthesia we are going to take up for the procedure. With this, I would like to conclude and wish everybody good health and a great year ahead and successful practice. Yes, advocating topical anesthesia. Nothing wrong with this anesthesia, but do take all precautions and be careful when you do surgeries under topical. Thank you, Dr. Prakash, for being with us today. It will be great to meet you physically in future, and we look forward to meet you, sir. That was great. And every panelist out here gave a beautiful presentation, and I thank everybody from the core of my heart.
Thank you, Dr. Khadri.
So
that was
I would leave the meeting
wonderful.
Now, thank you so much. Mr. Sanjay, for conducting the session so beautifully.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr.